Ham Radio Now, episode 206. Navassa fever. I have a case of Navassa fever. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. And it sort of stems from getting the video up from I was going to say the Tapper, because I should be working on Tapper right now, but I'm not. I'm working on Navassa fever from the DX forum back at the Dayton Hamvention. When I put that up on the YouTube channel, I saw this, and I'm going, KC4DX Navassa Island, 1972 is kind of early for a video. So I dialed it up, and I took a look at it, and looked like this.
Welcome to the video from the KC4DX DXpedition to Navassa Island, 1972. This was shot in Super 8 by our good friend Steve, WA4VWV.
And it was well narrated.
We had broken the team into two parts. Team A would arrive on Wednesday, Team B on Thursday, and this is Neil, WB4UPC with the 80-pound toolbox. Phil, W4GTS.
Where do you see who's coming up in a moment here?
Phil SB303 under his arm. And that's me, Chaz, W4GKF, with the SB401 under his arm. That's Bill's transmitter as well. Next day, we pick up Team B back at the airport. That's Wayne Green with a bad toupee.
Okay, so looking back at the information that came under the video, led me to this website, KC4DX, in May 1972, and the website's very extensive description of what went on, and it led me to the guy who put up the website, and that is Chaz Cone, W4GKF, and here's Chaz.
And there he is, looking exactly the same.
Not too bad, not too shabby, considering that if one were to play the video, and I invite everybody to go back and play the entire video. It's about 15 minutes long. It's very well done, very good documentation of the 1972 version, considering the technology of the day for video.
Thank you to Costco for converting the 8mm to DVD, and then I had to go edit that, so it took a long time.
Yeah, you can find out about that, and to me it was a particularly interesting comparison to the current DXpedition, the K4UEE and W4GJ's expedition that just concluded. I imagine, Chaz, you were pretty interested in watching that.
More than that, I was a webmaster for that website as well. I've known Bob and Glenn and those guys for decades, and I do websites as a thing I do anyway, and so they asked me to be the webmaster. My pleasure to do so.
So you were in your 30s, and most of the guys were in their 30s for the 1972 version. One of the things that impressed me when Bob and Glenn were doing their talk was to say that most of the people that were on this expedition were in their 60s. I guess that says a fair amount about ham radio. You're a little bit past 60s now, right?
Yeah, I'm 75. I know I don't look it.
No, you got all that hair and it's not all gray.
That's true.
Know, some Grecian formula in there.
I think the real reason for the age discrepancy is that when we did our expedition in 1972, it was cheap. The entire cost of the expedition, except for travel to and from Jamaica, was $5,000. Compare that to $300,000 for K1N, and you can see why it takes older people to do them now.
Did you wish that you had been able to go on this one?
Well, I suspected Bob was going to invite me simply because I would have killed him if he hadn't. But I'm not a triple threat operator, so I don't do digital. I don't do any CW anymore. So they needed operators who could go on all three modes, and I simply wasn't one. Plus, the terrain of Navassa Island is pretty rugged, and I'm not sure at my age I'd been really good for that. At the time, they weren't going to use helicopters, and I couldn't see climbing the rope ladder and all that business again, so I made it easy for him and told him not to ask me.
The 1972, you were the coordinator for that.
Yeah, I was responsible for 10 lives, which is a lot of pressure because it's a really pretty poor place to try to survive in. And of course, we were so ignorant in our 30s that we didn't know it couldn't be done, so we just went ahead and did it.
Was that your first DXpedition, or had you been on some before?
I'd been on a couple of the hotel, throw wire out the window of a hotel kind of things in Navassa, in Nassau and places like that. But this was the first tent and generator expeditions of my lifetime.
So how did you end up being the guy that ran the show?
Whenever I'm in a group of people, it turns out I'm always that guy. I'm the foreman on the jury. That's just who I am, and there was no competition for the job. Believe me, we drew a 2,000-mile circle around Atlanta to try to pick some place, the rarest place in that circle, and Navassa was it. And of course, all the naysayers came out of the woodwork. Well, you can't go to Navassa because the Coast Guard controls access, and they won't give you access. And so I got access. They said, well, that's fine, but you won't get a call sign from the FCC. They don't give those out. And so I got KC4DX, and I started scouting around for nine other people to make the trip. It took 10 of us because, and you ready for this? That's the maximum capacity of the boat we hired. And in order to be a candidate for our expedition, all you had to do is have 2 weeks off of your life and $500 in cash. If you met those two criteria, you're on the team.
So you don't have to be a triple threat operator. You could, you know, operate sideband, CW, you know, any mode that you're competent in.
We picked people who are proficient in more than one, but in general, there were CW guys and phone guys.
Okay. One of the things that gets pointed out both in the video and the website is that, first of all, the video was... You shot the film in 1972, but the video itself you put up just last September.
Right.
So that's actually fairly new. Did you put that up in anticipation of the K1N operation?
Well, I was working on research with Bob Alf and K4UE on Navassa and all that, since there are very few people you can talk to who've actually been there. And so I said, well, I've got a video. My gosh, I don't even know where that is. So I called my wife. I said, honey, do you know where the Navassa video, have you seen the Navassa video? And she said, about 1,000 times. I said, no, where is actually the can of film? And we found that and had it converted so we could play with it. That was, yes, I guess you could say K1N is the impetus for putting the video up.
Okay, so so it was still just on film at that point, and that's when you had it converted?
Right. It's trivial. It's very inexpensive these days. I had no idea. I think it was $25 or something to convert the thing to a DVD, and then I was able to bring it to an editor and do some editing on it and add the voiceover.
How did you do the voiceover? Did you find a studio?
Oh, gosh, no. I'm sitting here with a headset on, a USB microphone, and watching the video and talking. That's the total lack of professionalism involved with that.
Well, you do have some technology and some skills, because not everybody can do that.
No, it was adequate to the purpose.
It was great. There's another Navassa 8mm video, this 1978 version.
Right.
It's silent. So
my friend Dave Johnson, the K4SSU, was on that trip. So when we have a DX Club meeting here in Atlanta, you say, how many people have been to Navassa? 8 or 9 guys stand up.
Not very many people can say, or clubs can say that. So, but that one is totally silent. And so yours was far more compelling because people, you were telling us what was going on.
I also have a narrated PowerPoint presentation I'm working on. I've had it for a long, long time. And I'm going to add audio to that and put it up on YouTube, but probably a month or so.
Okay, well, that will be awesome. There are so many questions to ask, but the first one I want to go to is among the folks that you identified, especially as Silent Keys, was the one that almost everybody is going to recognize, Wayne Green, W2NSD, the editor and founder of 73 Magazine, was on this trip.
And over there, avoiding work, is Wayne Green.
He was. I contacted Wayne because he'd been to Navassa before for information, and he said, gee, I'd like to go. I said, really? Cool. Because I figured that would at least get us a cover story in 73 Magazine, and it did. The magazine cover and the entire article are on that website you pointed to a while ago, kc40x.com. Wayne turned out to be an okay guy. I may be the only guy in the world who never had a problem with Wayne Green, because Wayne's ego is immense. He passed away last year at 92 or so. But he was a, you know, an odd guy in many, many ways, but he was a great asset to our team because of the publicity we got from it. And it helped raise money to cover the $5,000 we spent.
What kind of operator was he?
He's pretty good. I don't think he spent much time operating. He had designated himself as the expedition photographer. So all the stills, you'll see most of the stills were taken by Wayne. And all the work, when work parties were going, he was some distance away taking pictures. He was close to the oldest guy on the trip at the time. I'm not sure how old he was. The oldest guy was Phil, W4GTS, who was 52 or 53, I think.
Okay, I think you've got some pictures here on the website. Let's see if I can dial down and see. Yeah, there's a few of them.
Yeah, there's. We tried to illustrate as best we could. Some of those pictures, I wasn't thinking of headshots, and so I had to go drag those out of various things. It's not all not created equal. There's Wayne in the red shirt.
Yep. So one of the things I was thinking of was the permission that you were talking about to go there. The guys from K1N talked about it being harder to get to than the moon because it took them 13 years to secure permission. How long did it take for you, and what had to be done back then?
Well, it was altogether different. Ever since Fish and Wildlife took over access, it's become more of a political thing than anything else. When we did it, the Coast Guard had a purview there. They were the people who gave you the permission to go, and you made an application. They sent you 14 pages of a very small type on 8.5 by 14 paper, saying that you were likely going to die, and if you got into trouble, we're not coming for you, and all that business. You had to sign your life away to get permission to go. So we did that, thinking that's just, you know, they'll come, they'll have to come, won't they have to come, and not. So it was easy. I think it took me 3 months to get permission to go. Not so bad.
But fortunately, no serious injuries or problems.
None at all. I'm not a good sailor, as you'll get from the website. So I threw up over the rail the whole way over there. But on the way back, I was fine because the pressure was off. I was worried that somebody would get hurt. And, you know, there's really no easy way to get help for somebody if they do. I mean, we had a first aid kit, but we didn't have a physician, for example, as part of our team, although K1N had three. So they were smart about that.
Because you're all older now.
My wife said they're all too old now.
Yeah. They did the helicopter thing in and out. They had a ship, but the ship couldn't be relied on to be their equipment, transportation, and full in and out because they didn't know if they'd be able to. Well, you can't land a ship there, but they didn't know if they'd be able to use it. Turns out they were able to, but they probably couldn't have done all of the equipment that they brought in and out using the ship, so they added a helicopter to it, which is, I think, you know, the most significant part of the expense. You guys didn't consider helicopter?
Well, in 1972, there weren't commercial helicopters available for rent in Jamaica or any place else in the Caribbean, and we couldn't have considered it for the price. Really, we had a $5,000 budget. Now, we were only there 2.5 days. It's not like they were there for 2 weeks like these guys. So if we were going to be there that long, it would have cost quite a lot more. But we had actually, the capacity of the boat was a governing thing on how many people could go. And we knew how we had to get on the island. We had to climb a rope ladder. And that rope ladder is since gone. So landing by boat for enough stuff for 2 weeks would be a massive endeavor. Helicopter is the only way to do it, especially at the age of the players.
When you're saying the rope ladder was gone, they talked about that. They showed where it would have been. You said you didn't know it would be there when you arrived, and you had no plan B.
That is correct. We assumed it was there, and somebody had a light airplane had flown by a month before, and it was still there. And so we didn't have a plan B. That is correct. We might have had to blow the whole thing off. But again, when you blow off a $5,000 DXpedition, not such a big deal.
Well, it was $1972, so there, you know, there's
that's true.
There's that.
It's true. The oldest fellow in our group, Phil W4GTS, who's now a silent key, we got there. He was not going to do the ladders. I'm not going. I said, Phil, you did not come all this way and not get on the island. You're getting on the damn rope ladder. And we browbeat him until he did, and it was trivial up and down the rope ladder. Not like a walk in the park, but not so bad.
Now, didn't he know what he was in for before he left? I mean, there were pictures and things.
Oh, yeah. He knew. He just lost his nerve at the end.
Yeah. Okay, so you guys weren't the first DXpedition there. You said that Wayne had been there before, and Don Miller, a W9WNV, in his talk, Ed Dayton had talked about having been there. In fact, I think there was some controversy about his DXpedition from there.
Yeah, there had been six or seven before we went, maybe four or five.
Oh, so a lot.
Yeah, we were nowhere near the first to go. We were the first to go in quite a while. And we made a magnificent number of contacts, considering the amount of effort, 5,400 contacts. I still have the logs. If you if you work KC4DX and don't have a card, get in touch with me. I have the logs.
So 5,400 contacts is what K1N did in the first half hour?
Right, pretty much. They did 140 queues, but they had, three
140,000.
Did I say 40? 140.
Yeah.
But they were on the air from with three rigs 24/7. So
they were they just running three stations?
They had a fourth, but mostly they had I think three stations. Don't hold me to it. I wasn't there, but it's either three or four on the air all the time. The big advantage they had was they were up near the lighthouse, and they hung dipoles and inverted L's and all off the lighthouse, which, as they say in their presentation, they had better low-band antennas than most people they worked. And of course, being out in the middle of the ocean, that's a big benefit as well. We operated from Lulu Bay, which was probably 200 feet lower with a ridge in the way. But you'd be surprised how you get 5.9 reports when you're the DX.
What direction were you blocked if you were down below that part of the island? There must have been a part of the world you couldn't work.
We couldn't work any place. If you were looking for an optimum antenna location, we were pretty much optimum for South America. But that cuts off the rest of the world. But it didn't seem to matter. We had great propagation, and the sunspot cycle was really excellent then too compared to now.
So this was an era before DX packet clusters, the internet, any kind of advance information, any kind of easy advance information. You'd indicated in the video that as soon as you turn things on, boom. How did you get the word out that you were going to be there?
Well, we had enough time for planning. That was part of my job, was to inform the DX community that was going to happen. So we had regular news releases to QST, to CQ, to 73 Magazine. We snail mailed all the DX clubs we get addresses for, and it was no secret when we went on the air. As you say, I was the first one on the microphone as soon as we finished contacting our home pilot to let our families know we were okay. And I said, so this is KC4DX, QRZ. And it was like this. You couldn't pick a call sign out with a needle. And we had to work by call areas. And we were simply, nobody was doing split frequencies in 1972. So we were simplex the whole time, which it was a challenge. It was a challenge. But I think everybody who wanted us got us, because the last day we were on the air before we got to the ship, back to the boat, was our lightest day. So we think we worked it out pretty well.
So you had three stations on the air yourselves, approximately the same as the Navassa guys, just for less time. And what, two on phone, one on CW?
Yes, two on phone, one on CW. And they were all low-power stations. We had no amps. So the high-power station was a Swan 500C, or maybe it was a 350C, I can't remember. And the other two stations were Heathkit pairs. So we were 100 watts on two out of the three stations.
So the Heathkit pairs, with the Swan, you could not operate split. It didn't have separate VFO or any of those capabilities. But the Heathkit pairs could have. Was that a concept that was not widely in practice at that time?
Yes, it wasn't that they were incapable. It's that nobody was really doing that. The QRM you have now on a DX station is 100,000 times greater than it was back in 1972. Also, people were more well-mannered back in 1972, for whatever that's worth. The real challenge we had, I think, was pretty punk antennas. We had a Hustler 4BTV, and we had a Mosley Classic Junior, not Classic, TV 33 Junior, is that what they're called? Can't remember.
I think
we unpacked it. The casting, one of the castings that held the boom element to the boom, was broken. So that antenna was put together with duct tape, which in 1972 we still had. So our antennas were not great, and our power was low. but we were working stations all the time.
As you were saying, they were incented to be able to hear you.
You bet.
Yeah, and they did. So this was a learning by doing experience for you and how to handle pileups like that?
Exactly. We'd never been, except for those little hotel things. Of course, you know, if you want to be DX, get a portable radio and a wire antenna and go get in a hotel in Jamaica, and you can have a pileup going that you won't believe, because Jamaicans are not famous for good QSLing, and so you can do all this with a whole lot less effort than getting a generator and gasoline and going to a desert island. We had not much experience with that. In fact, we had not much experience with anything. And having to do with this, we just rolled it out as we could. I had a guy in charge of logistics, a guy in charge of antennas, a guy in charge of radio maintenance, a guy in charge of taking pictures. We kind of divided up the work, and I guess it's something of a miracle it all went down as well as it did, and no one was hurt.
How did you, as you were learning this stuff, how did you go about doing it? What decisions did you make on the fly about how to make these contacts? How to pull out these the call signs from the immense noise that you were hearing over the headphones?
When it was really rough, the strategy you used was calling by areas. Most of the noise came from the United States. We'd call by areas. I remember one day I was trying to get a message to my wife, who was with our baby daughter up in New Jersey while I was gone. And I said into the pileup, I'd like to work a station in New Jersey, please. I said, Northern New Jersey. Okay, near Boonton, New Jersey. and I got a phone patched into her that way. It was amazing.
So a little bit quieter each time, but...
A little bit, but not much. Because people from California thought they were close to Boonton, New Jersey, and they'd be willing to pay... Remember, long-distance phone calls cost money in those days.
Yeah.
And so anybody would be happy to get in the log to provide a phone patch on a DXpedition. My wife said she talked to me more on those 3 days, and she talked to me the other 3 days of our lives.
So you did a fair amount of communicating with folks at home, and probably the other guys on the team did as well.
Yep.
No satellite phones.
Oh, no. It was just a fantastic adventure with a bunch of luck associated therewith, no question. And, of course, if you got one of these back in 1972, you were a hero.
So where did that call sign come from? You said that the FCC assigned it to you. The KC-4 was an assigned prefix for Navassa at the time?
That's correct. KC-4 was a prefix, and I asked for KC-4DX, and of course, like I said, naysayers all said, oh, that'll never happen. And it came through pretty fast, really. That's just how things worked. It was, if you don't know something's impossible, it turns out not to be impossible often.
Now and then the FCC came up with special call signs, probably fairly informally, because my timeline isn't real good for this, but I don't think the vanity program had been hinted at that point, even for extras.
No. There wasn't any such thing. And now what they do is the ARRL has license over the 1x1s. So that's how you get K1N. The FCC doesn't even participate in that process, as far as I know. The ARRL has the ability to assign 1x1s, and that's why you see so many of those out there now.
Yeah, and I'm not sure that I would want a 1x1 like that, because it's not exclusive to you. A K1N will appear on something else sometime in the probably not too distant future. Although people may stay away from that because of the connection with Navassa, at least for a while, but there's no exclusivity. It can be reassigned practically at will. So I'm not sure I'd want that.
Well, and of course, it's a challenge for the QSL manager, because right now the K1N page, I manage the K1N page, and when somebody else says that call sign, I'm going to have to hand that responsibility off to whoever that is to avoid being deluged with questions about the exhibition with which I have nothing to do.
Yeah,
it's a challenge. But if you're a CW guy, 1x1, pretty good thing.
It's fast. The KC4DX has also been reassigned. It belongs to
some chap, and I have a link on my page. If you're looking for him, go here. He has a link on his page. If you're looking for him, go there. So we're cooperating in that. I'd love to have that call sign myself, but some other chap has it now, and God bless him.
So you ended up going on more DXpeditions after this one was over.
Yes, but nothing is it requires much energy as this. When Save Island came along, we did our same group from Atlanta opened Save Island on 10-10-10 when that became a legal entity and its own licensing entity. So we went down there and did that, and that was a hotel and plug-in-the-wall power kind of situation when we had to manage antennas. But yes, I've been on several. Nothing like this, though.
So they call that kind of holiday mode, or where were you blood and guts 24 hours a day just from a more comfortable?
We had a comfortable operating environment, but it was still balls out making contacts. Because nobody had ever worked Saba before that day, ever. And so the buildup of people who wanted it was quite high.
What's your experience now with the growth of ham radio, the number of people that are doing this sort of thing? You were saying earlier that it was... The volume of people that you had to deal with was much smaller, and so it's like lots bigger today.
Well, I think so. I don't know. What do we have? 400,000 licensees now in the United States.
I think we're talking 740 or 50. So
yeah, so it was 10% or 20% of that in 1972.
Yeah,
and everybody wasn't into DX back then. DX has become a lot more popular subset of the hobby than it was back in the 70s. I think. I'm very gratified to see licenses grow, but they're growing at the VHF end of the world, and we have several clubs. I'm a part of one that's trying to drive folks into the general and extra category and get that excitement going for working DX.
But this Navassa operation that just concluded seemed immensely popular. I don't think their pileups ever really died.
No, that's true, because they were number one or number two on the most wanted list. So if you're number one or two on the most wanted list, you're going to get attention, no question.
Yeah.
Now that's the North Korea's up there alone at the top.
Are you still an active DXer? Do you still look for every signal you can eke out?
I do, and thanks to the cluster capability, I don't have to sit and turn the knob all the time. I have it configured to let me know when something I need is on. I run down the basement and work them. It's not quite as challenging as it used to be, but when you're over 300, there's not that many opportunities.
When you guys, you did send out your publicity to let people know that you'd be on the air. Did you list a specific frequency, or did people have to go hunt for you?
No, I can't recall, to tell you the truth. It was forever ago. I think we indicated operating frequency, but perhaps not at the time. I really don't remember if we did or not. I figured that if you're a DXpedition that's popular, they will search you out.
They'll find you. Well, I mean, we didn't have pan adapters back then. I think maybe Heathkit had sort of a pan adapter, so you could see the big spike in activity happening someplace. But yeah, got it, you know, the old fashioned way. You just had to go find it.
We only worked 10, 15, 20, 40, and 80. There were no work bands back in those days, so the number of places you could find this was limited. And of course, you work from 10 meters down as the propagation goes, and it's pretty. The techniques are pretty much the same. If we'd been able to work split regularly, that would have made the pileups easier to work. But we still had pretty darn good QSO rates.
Yep. So I was saying that the Heathkits could have done split. It was just not something that you guys considered.
It wasn't typical the way the world worked.
Yeah. Don Miller was hinting at that in his talk. That was a concept he was trying to get introduced, and that would have been a few years earlier, but I guess it's not something that became real popular yet.
I think that's true. And it could be that we were simply sufficiently ignorant not to have thought of that. we really monopolized the ignorant category pretty well.
And you were saying that the hams were better behaved back then. So what have you been seeing, and how long has it been not the case?
It's been not the case for at least 10 years, maybe longer. It's a lack of common courtesy. You can put some of it down to language issues, but when you ask the Italians to stand by and all you get are calls from eyes, it's I don't know, they figure they can make their way through, although no properly managed expedition calls anybody outside their rules, because it contributes to it. Plus, there's deliberate QRM now that we didn't have before. That I think is a very, very bad thing. But we're working on that.
Yeah, deliberate QRM when you're operating split is going to be somewhat ineffective, because they can't QRM the whole pileup, and they can attempt to QRM the DX station, but that's only going to bother. Everybody knows who it is and where they are, so I guess if they have finally isolated your call sign and are calling you back and you're getting interference, you would not copy that, so... I guess that would be a
problem. The real problem is QRM on the DXpedition is transmitting some frequency, because a powerful station can wipe you out depending on where you are in the world. And we had DQRM stations identified in every continent. It wasn't just us, and it wasn't just the Europeans. Everybody had somebody participating in that terrible activity. The only objective would be to spoil someone else's fun. I don't see why people do that, but they do.
So, what would the top maybe 2-3 things be in your mind that DXers ought to do better than they do right now?
They certainly should obey the instructions from the DX operator. If you do that, you'll get through. With the splits as wide as they have had to be somehow, it's just your chance of working with somebody is diminished dramatically if you don't do what the operator says. You listen first, you call when you're asked to, and you keep your transmission short. One of the guys on Navassa, I think, had a 300 Q an hour rate going for a while. That's amazing. That has to do with cooperation of the DX calling group.
So the things that, and I am no DXer and never have been. I've been a ham for 50 years, and I am able to work DX contacts just by tuning across the band and finding them and calling them and, you know, whatever the pileup is. And if it's not too bad, they hear my 100 watts, even mobile, which is, I really like doing that. The things that I notice are that the pileup gets extended by a long time because people will continue to call after 10 or 15 seconds. If the DX station responds to one of those guys near the tail end, because that's the only call they could pick out, they're just asking for it at that point.
That's right. Yeah, it's not easy. It takes a lot of skill on both ends to make a DX contact with a rare entity. It does. And the answer is to keep trying. What we like to try to do is to give your call sign once and wait and see if he works somebody else. Because several of the stations in Navassa were continually tuning over the split area. I mean, they make one contact and not listen on that frequency again until they were, you know, until it came back around again. So it works. It works if your objective is, and their objective, of course, is what it should be, which is to work the maximum number of people for the time that they're there, because it's not going to be on the air again for at least 10 years. So it won't be climbing up that list anytime soon after 140,000 Qs.
And the other thing that I actually heard somebody say on Ham Nation, which surprised me, is that the DX operation will announce a range of frequencies, typically 5 or 10 kilohertz wide. And I'm not going to say who this is because I'm a little bit surprised he said it, but he said, so if you want a better chance, scoot yourself just outside that a little bit. Would the good DX operator do that, and would the DX station acknowledge it?
I wouldn't think so. That would not be an appropriate thing to do. I kind of think you'd be 1 kilohertz north or south of the thing because you hear the voice, you know, out of phase. But the right thing to do is to do what the operator tells you to do. Had a case where on the Navassa, where the operator would say exactly, he'd say listening 030, and if you listen to him, he would tell you where he's going to be listening the very next time. Most people were talking instead of listening.
Yeah, I caught that. The people are looking at the video that I did. It took me several playbacks of the CW that I was hearing, because my Morse code skills are not very good. I thought they were sending, no NA. Turns out they were sending 09. They wanted you to send on 09 when they were looking for CW contacts, and that's where everybody was, and it seemed to work out okay. Any other tips, any other specific techniques that you've gleaned from both sides of this equation?
I don't think I'm qualified. I think it's all common sense. There is a published DX code of conduct, and if you can find that on almost every club website, a link to DX code of conduct, and it tells you how to be a responsible person on the not DX end of the game. And if you do that, you'll get in log sooner. My objective when I'm on an expedition is to get the call right. Some people will just get the call the best they can and let the world sort it out. I believe that's the responsibility of the DX operator to get the call and the log correctly, no matter how long that takes. because otherwise that guy's going to keep calling you forever more and just add to the pileup. So it's all common sense. It's all common sense.
Okay. Well, you may not feel like you're the most authoritative person, but you've got a lot of experience. Plus, you're the guy on my Skype line right now. So
that's true.
Sticking you with this deal.
Captive audience. I can say what I like until the editor comes along.
Yep. All right. Is there anything else I haven't covered that has been on the back of your mind that you'd like to tell the massive audience that we'll pick up for this show?
I'm really, really proud of the K1 and Expedition and what they did, and FT5ZM, and all the guys who spend upwards of $250,000 to $500,000 being DX. I don't think the public understands exactly what a huge economic pressure that is to make that whole thing happen. And I urge everybody out there to financially support these big DXpeditions because they really, really need the money in order to avoid being murdered financially. For example, on K1N, half of that $300,000 was put up by those operators. So it's not a trivial thing to be on one, and it's certainly not a trivial thing to make enough money to cover the cost. So I urge everybody to contribute.
All right. And I urge everybody to stop by YouTube, and I'll put a link on the Ham Radio Now pages and stuff, but it shouldn't be hard to find, the KC4DX, and watch the whole video, because you did a great job with some pretty ancient technology for the 1970s.
Thank you very much, and be sure to notice how much I look exactly the same.
pretty close anyway. It's pretty amazing. Well, thank you very much, Chaz. And that will be it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Arvin, speaking of folks who are trying to stick their hand in your pocket, Arvin is imploring me to remind you that Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. So if you enjoy the programs, stop by our website. And I heard something whistle in the background. You got a bird there?
No, my new email alert is an R2-D2 snap. Sorry.
Okay.
I'm a Star Wars geek. I can't help.
I could make that go away, but I think I'll leave it in there. So hamradionow.tv, this little website thing you can see down there, and help us out. 73 Chaz, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. You are?
Chaz W4GKF. Thank you, Gary.
Over and out.